has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He were my shield and portion me as long as life.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Know what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart, something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. And the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me. Thank you.
I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing and hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
I know your life on earth was troubled, and only you could know. Son, your word gone. that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace.
We have gathered here this afternoon to pay our last respects, bid our last farewell, and to celebrate the life of who was in life, Barclay Coe. It's never good for the family to lose a loved one. It doesn't matter their age, doesn't matter their accomplishment, it doesn't matter what circumstance. The loss is always painful. So for the family, it is good to have you come and support them at a time like this. We pray that everything that takes place in the service will serve to comfort, to encourage not only the family, but each of us, and also that we will be challenged to live what is left of life for us in such a way that we will spend eternity with Jesus. Mm-hmm. Just would like to acknowledge the Lions Club, of which Barclay was a part. I'd like to acknowledge also the Alzheimer's Association, and the people that are here representing the Customs Department. Everybody else, we acknowledge you as well. Thank you for offering this support. The order of the service as laid out in the program will now be followed as it has been laid out. I will not be calling out every item. Everyone that is participating will just move forward where you have been listed. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to invite you to stand and join us in the singing of "To God Be the Glory."
Oh, yeah. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, our Savior, the resurrection from the dead, the Holy Spirit, our Comforter. How much we thank you today, O God, that even in the midst of the mourning and grief, we can lean on you because our hope is in you. We thank you, God, that because of the death of your Son, Jesus Christ, we need not mourn today as those who have no hope. But even, God, though the human part of us mourn, we know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Because, Almighty God, you have given us that promise. And we can stand upon that promise today. Because you are the one, O God, who turn our night into day. Thank you for that hope, O God. Thank you for that hope that we have in you. That hope that we will be rejoined with our loved ones in time to come. And so, Father God, we thank you for the life that you have given to us for a season, the life that you have now taken unto yourself. We thank you, God, for the footprints that he has left behind. And we pray, Father God, that even as we celebrate his life today, each of us will be very conscious of the fact that we too will be celebrated in time to come. Yes. May we be ready, O God. May today be a day that reminds us of the need to be ready. And so as we come to worship, Lord, we pray that you will accept the worship and the praise that we send up to you right now. And that, O God, each family member will be comforted to your word. Through your abiding presence, they will know, God, that you have not abandoned them, but you are with them even in the midst of their grief. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good afternoon. I want to start off by thanking all of you for coming out today to celebrate and honor our father's life. Today is one of the hardest days of our lives. Death is a part of life. And once it strikes someone you so dearly love, your existence will never be the same. There are not enough words and time today to express how much our father meant to Craig and I. What a loving and supportive father he was to us, a father figure to Nicholas, and a doting grandfather to him and Kaylee, nor all the ways he impacted our lives. Daddy went above and beyond to ensure we had everything we needed, so I will just say a few words. What is the measure of a man? Is it the amount of money he has, the possessions he owns, and the power he holds? Is it the professional success he's achieved over the years? The true measure of a man is how much love he gives. How selflessly he shares whatever he can to help others. How consistently he lifts up those around him with a kind word, a funny joke, a compliment, a humble ear, or the very shoes off his feet. A father. A light is from our household gone. A voice we loved is stilled. A place is vacant in our home, which never can be filled. God gave us a beautiful father, a father who never grew old. You were always there with a helping hand. Help us now to accept his plan. We miss you now, our hearts are sore. As time goes by, we miss you more. Your loving smile, your gentle face, no one can take our father's place. May the choirs of the angels receive you, and may you have rest and peace everlasting. Amen. We feel so grateful to have had as much time with our father as we did. We miss him so much already and will forever remember having the most incredible dad. We cherish the many memories we have with our father and know he is smiling down on all of us. Thank you again for coming out today to celebrate the memory of our amazing father. Daddy, we will love you always. And you will forever be in our hearts.
Good afternoon. A tribute on behalf of the grandchildren. A tribute to our Papa. The love we have for Papa will never fade away. We'll think of him, our special friend, throughout each passing day. We'll walk into the room and see his empty chair. Although we know he's resting, we'll feel his presence there. The memories of his laughter, his warm and loving smile, his eyes so full of happiness, his heart that of a child. Memories are forever, be they laughter or of tears. Memories we will treasure through all the forthcoming years. You will always be in our hearts. Love you always, Papa, Nicholas and Kaylee. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I must say that it saddens me to be here this evening on behalf of Customs Border Control Service to deliver this tribute, as Mr. Barclay was one of my mentors. When I first joined the Legacy Customs at a tender age of 19 years old. And with that said, on behalf of the Customs and Border Control Service, I extend our sincere condolences to the family of the late Barclay Coe, especially his daughter, Amaris, and his son, Craig. Mr. Coe joined the Legacy Customs Department in 1973. To put that in perspective, I was only 6 years old. As a deputy collector, and served as the only deputy until 1986, when the organization structure changed to include another two additional deputies on staff. As the only deputy in the organization, he was tasked with the responsibilities of customs operations at all locations, which included ports, trade and revenue, and administration portfolio, a role that would not fit in today's expanded operations. At the time, his role held him accountable for the management of large volumes of imports and passengers across our borders, and for collecting approximately a third of government's overall revenue. Being customer service driven, he was instrumental in streamlining customs business processes, which helped to enhance travel and trade facilitation. And he was well known by many merchant traders for his excellent customer service. It was under his watch as deputy, the first customs law was established on September 4th, 1990. This led to structural changes within the organization, such as the establishment of a training unit and then the customs task force, which was responsible for customs inspections, border security, and investigations. Over time, the department grew and became known as one of the key law enforcement agencies locally and regionally. It is important to mention that Mr. Cole had a love for sports, and baseball was one of those at the time. And he played on the customs volleyball team, which was a team to be reckoned with back in the early days. As the time progressed, and shortly after the implementation of the customs law, Mr. Cole decided to retire in 1991, leaving a department that his career was built in and he was fond and proud of. Mr. Cole had given such dedicated service to the department that after his retirement, he found it difficult to detach himself and continue to visit and offer advice and generally just checked to ensure that we were functioning at a high professional standard that had become the hallmark of legacy customs. On behalf of the Customs and Border Control Service, and by extension, the wider civil service, I would like to officially acknowledge Mr. Cole's 18 years of law enforcement service and his contribution to the economic growth and development of the Cayman Islands. His passing has had an emotional impact on his legacy customs colleagues. May his soul rest in peace, and may light perpetual shine upon him.
Will all Lions and members of the Lions family please be upstanding? Lion Barclay loved a good roar, but they don't want us roar up in this place. What I ask you all to stand for is so that we can observe a moment's silence in honor of our fallen brother, and we so do now. Thank you, fellow Lions. You may be seated. Early in 1981, when Lion Barclay's wife, Cecile, died, I can't remember seeing more sadness pour out of one human being ever. We all worried about him, but he didn't desert us. And for quite some time, we danced around that sadness. And when we saw the spark of life coming back, we knew we were able to then begin to help the healing. Family was one thing, but the Lions family was also important to him. And eventually he became the Lion Barclay that we knew once more. And we all thank God for it, and we enjoyed his fellowship for many years after that. He was a funny little fellow sometimes. I remember when we were building the original Lion Center building, the small one. Why call the small one to inward by made up? Whenever we worked on a Sunday, Lion Welly would always bring a pot of soup the size of me. And Barclay would have his share. And then when he was ready to go, just about when all of us were ready to go, he would say, okay, I'm leaving here now because you come here all day and they work you to death and they not give you one single thing to eat. That was his way of saying, thank you, my belly is full. And so Lion Alfonso, by making a few phone calls and checking with a few of the old stalwarts, wrote this tribute from us to be read at this celebration service for Lion Barclay Co. On behalf of Lion President Michael Havlin and the membership of the Lions Club of Grand Cayman and the Lions family throughout the Cayman Islands, we offer to Lion Barclay's family our heartfelt condolences on his passing. The Lions Club of Grand Cayman received its official charter from the International Association of Lions Clubs on the 6th of October, 1972. And on November 21st of that same year, an official ceremony in the Royal Palms Hotel welcomed 54 men into the brotherhood of the largest service organization in the free world. Lion Barclay Co. served on the very first board of directors, and he went on to serve as the club's fifth president in 1977. The 1977-78 administration was pivotal to the development of the still relatively young club. Barclay, along with his two brothers, Sems and Ulrich, joined at the same time, and until today is still the only three siblings team to serve in the club at the same time. His brother Sims is now one of only six charter members that are still members of the club. Barclay was a committed and a very dedicated member from the very start and made his presence felt in all areas of the club. At the time, the club was extremely busy and was creating quite a stir all over the place. The Leo Club had recently been chartered, and construction on the original Lions Community Center had commenced, and that was in full swing. And Lion Barclay made time on the weekends to be there to do his part. The site conservation program had been launched, and Lion Barclay was the first president to take this program to Cayman Brac. He had decided when accepting the presidency that rather than try to establish new projects, his administration would work to shore up and improve on already established projects, a decision which proved to be very beneficial to the club at the time. Lion Barclay Co. was a humanitarian to the core, and he always went the extra mile to make sure that the less fortunate in our community were looked after. Service in those days required much sacrifice, and everything was hands-on. The landline telephone was our only means of communication, but somehow it seemed like we got a lot more done. Barclay was there as passionate and committed and as involved as anyone else. A wonderful lion to be around, hardworking and fun-loving, and was always up to some mischief. I can't tell you some of them. Usually stirring some pot to make trouble for someone and pretending to not be involved. A calming disposition, and easy to talk to, and ever so willing to nurture and give advice to younger members. And I can tell you all about that. Len Barclay was a stalwart member of our club, and his many efforts and sacrifices helped to bring relief to many needy families in these communities in which we serve. He was awarded life membership in 1992, and he also was the recipient of many awards during his tenure, including being awarded a Melvin Jones Fellow and the Thomas Hurlston Lionheart Award. I tell you today, the Cayman Islands and its people are privileged beneficiaries of his decades of unselfish service. We salute him, and we offer our thanks to his family for the many times he had to leave them so he could come with us to help others. Others that had sight problems, nothing to eat, and nowhere to sleep. He truly exemplified the motto of our club and that of Lions International. And that motto is simple, two words: we serve. These Cayman Islands are a much better place because of caring and dedicated individuals like our Lion Barclay Co. Rest in peace, our dear brother in service.
At this time, I'd like to invite you to join in the singing of Blessed Assurance. To make sure that we keep awake accepting the family, please stand for the singing of Blessed Assurance. Not the family, the family gets it.
Purchase of God, born of his will.
and Barclay make me get a platterman. I was speaking earlier on about, and I'm not going to dwell on it for very long because I know it brings back bad memories for some, but I was speaking about when Cecile passed away. And Barclay's two children were 6 and 3. That was rough. But as I read his life story, you will see that he was part of a very closely knit family unit. And that family unit still exists today. And we all thank God for that. I thought to tell you all a few of my memories with Lion Barclay, especially in the club. But I decided not to, because some of them, not that he was a bad fella, that's not what I'm saying. But Lion Barclay loved to tease you so much. I remember without calling the name of our fellow lion, him, this fellow lion, coming to two different lion functions that we had. And all two times, he brought this girlfriend that he had, he said. And all two times, he introduced his girlfriend once again to everybody. The next function, I think it was, I can't remember exactly what it was. Anyway, he came, this lion came alone. So Lion Barclay leaned up on me. He said, "What happened?" I said, "What happened to what?" He said, "You don't see so-and-so is alone?" I said, "Well, maybe she's working." Yeah, I guess so. Anyway, Lion Barclay invented a song. Never said a word to the lion. But every time he crossed, he was talking about this person that was missing. And about after about the third or fourth time, the lion finally caught on. Boy, let me tell you something, the smoke was coming out of his ears. And Lion Barclay went on all the day, no smile on his face. Totally innocent. And of course, when he walked across to me, he leaned over. He said, I got him. That was Lion Barclay. I could tell you that one. There were a few more which, as I said, might not be so appropriate. And so, as I offer condolences on behalf of Shirley Ann and myself, Craig and Amaris and all the rest of the family, his siblings, and all of his extended family, we say to you, and we can say to you, not only with all sincerity, but with surety, that while it is sad that Lion Barclay is gone, and while we will forever miss him, we know that the life he lived, he's in a better place. And it is not like we are without hope. So as painful as it is, dwell on that with the understanding that we will meet again. Barclay Caldwell Coe was born on the 4th of March, 1936, in Bluefields, Nicaragua. His parents were Vernie and I think we would go Josefa Coe. And Barclay was the fourth of 8 children born to this union. Growing up, he helped out with family chores, and he loved exploring with his brothers. He and younger brother Tony would frequently go and cut down trees to make uprights and crossbars to practice high jump. He was a very disciplined child, and he gave little trouble to his parents, thank God. He was serious, but he always had a wonderful sense of humor. Church was a regular occurrence to the Coe family, and Barclay and his siblings attended Sunday school and church at the Moravian Church in Bluefields. He attended Colegio Moravo School from the time he was 5 years old until he graduated. He was a very good student, and his teachers spoke very highly of his problem-solving skills. From his early days, he aspired to be a dentist, but unfortunately, this aspiration did not materialize. During his school years, Barclay was an avid lover of sports. You heard Kevin allude to some of his escapades. He played baseball, soccer, and volleyball, and he excelled at all of them. But his true passion was always baseball. His favorite team was the Yankees. Win, lose, or draw, Yankees. He was one of the best baseball players in Bluefields, along with his second cousin and best friend, Henry Kirkland, and also his fellow classmate, Willie Hooker. They all played on the same team. Barclay played shortstop, Henry played second base, and Willie was the star pitcher. Actually, Willie went on to play professionally in the United States in later years. Their team was called the Strong Nine, and they won most of the games they played in their league. When he came to Cayman, he continued playing sports, and the Strong Nine baseball team resurfaced, adopting some Caymanian players. Sims and Barclay's brother-in-law, Ditto, played on the team as well. Strong Nine continued their winning legacy. However, there was that one time that the team lost the game. Now, for those of you who knew Mr. Lindbergh Eden, Mr. Lindbergh Eden was a smart little fella. He wasn't a big fella, but he was smart. So instead of his team riding from Savannah to Georgetown, he made Barclay's team, Strong Nine, ride from Georgetown to Savannah. And the team was so tired, they started the game right away, but Mr. Lindbergh's team beat them. He also played football, and he was a member of the volleyball team, as you've heard from the tribute from CBC of the Customs Department. Not only did he excel in sports, Barclay also knew his way around the dance floor. Especially us older Lions, we will remember that. He was an excellent bolero dancer in Bluefields, and he won many competitions while there. He brought this passion to Cayman, where he also won several competitions dancing the waltz. In August of 1954, Barclay's father passed away after a brief illness. And so, his older sister Mabel and her husband Randolph assisted Barclay's mother with Barclay, Nella, and Anthony's care and helped to raise them. And so Mabel was not only his older sister, but also his second mother. After graduating from high school, Barclay moved to Cayman to join his extended Caymanian family and two brothers, Ulrich and Sims, who had already moved here to complete their education. Didn't take him long when he got here to find out that the order of the day for just about all the young men was to go to sea. So he decided he would follow suit as a means of helping to provide for his family. And so he set sail with National Bulk Carriers as what was termed in those days OS, an ordinary seaman. Ordinary sailor. Which one? Seaman. Okay. I didn't go, as well you know. This was a short-lived adventure for Barclay, as he quickly realized that he really wasn't cut out for that sea life. That's pretty well why he and I were such good buddies. He was not about to go into a situation where he would spend prolonged periods. And so, away from home, that is. And so, by 1959, he was on his way back home. He started working with the government in 1963. He started off at the Public Works Department under the late Mr. Estela Tibbetts. John, you will remember Mr. Estela very well. This was the beginning of a very long, not just successful, but rewarding employment with the government, which would span almost 30 years. It was around the time when Barclay came home from sea that he noticed the girl next door. You see, when he came to Cayman first, he moved in with his aunt Clarice, who lived next door to Mr. Kingsley Thompson and his family. And of course, we know that Cecile was Mr. Kingsley's daughter. Of course, it didn't take Barclay long to notice her, the Barclay that we know. As luck would have it, Barclay went to work with H.O. Merrin and Company, only to find out that's where Cecile worked too. God was with him, he said. He was smitten with Cecile, and for him especially, it was love at first sight. He was determined to marry her. And he was pretty good with words now, so after a courtship which didn't last too very long, his determination said, you know what, I ain't fooling with nobody. And he took Cecile to Jamaica, and they eloped. And they were married on the 13th of April, 1964. As we know, to this very happy union were born two children, Craig the first on August 8th, 1974, and then Amaris on the 23rd of May, 1977. Their family was now complete, and the future looked really bright. But nothing would prepare them for what lay just ahead. Not long after Amaris was born, Cecile was diagnosed with cancer. Life would never be the same again. After a long and valiant fight battling this disease, their family life was shattered with the untimely and heartbreaking passing of Cecile on the 28th day of January, 1981. Barclay was left a widower with a really young family to raise. He was totally devoted to his children, and he loved them dearly. And his sister-in-law, Selma, who was Cecile's sister, and her husband, Charles Eden, they didn't have children. And they moved in with Barclay to help raise the two kids. And he was ever so grateful throughout his life for this intervention. He provided a loving home for his children, and he made sure they lacked nothing and had everything they needed, providing for them all the time and guiding them the best way he knew how. Of course, Cecile was the one who used to drive. Barclay never used to drive at all. So this meant that he now had to learn to drive in order to be able to take his children where they had to go. So Barclay took lessons with, I think it was Dexter Ebanks. I think it was Dexter Ebanks. And he got his license, he bought a car, and he took to the road so that he could take Craig and Amaris not only to school, but also to their various extracurricular activities. And once he learned how to drive and got his license, he put a whole pile of miles on that little green Toyota Corolla. Most of us from the early days will remember that vehicle too. That he was determined to make up for all the years that he wasn't driving. Barclay loved Cayman. And as one of his ways of giving back to a community that welcomed him when he first arrived, and as a commitment to the country he called home, he served the people of these islands in the capacity of special constable with the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service, a role he was proud to hold and a job he took very seriously. He was awarded the certificate and badge of honor for performing his duties with commendable efficiency during the visit of the late Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II and the late His Royal Highness the Duke of Edinburgh when they visited Cayman in February of 1983. He instilled this sense of community and service in his son Craig, who has been serving in this same capacity for many years and still does, I think. Still does. Quiet but efficient, like your dad. Barclay was also one of the charter members of the Lions Club, as you've heard before, serving on the first board of directors and also serving as president for the 1977-78 administration. He was a faithful and dedicated member of the club and could always be counted on to assist in the various activities of service in the islands. He was a committed and long-serving member of the club. And in January of this year, at the National Heroes Day celebrations, he received the Early Pioneer Award for Volunteerism and Charitable Services through his years of service in the Lions Club of Grand Cayman. Not to be forgotten, church life was important to Barclay, and he ensured that Craig and Amaris went to Sunday school and participated in other church activities. He himself was involved here at the Chapel Church, assisting with the children's choir and other youth activities, and he was also instrumental in raising money for the initial stage in the building of the Family Life Center over yonder. Later on, Barclay attended the Moravian Church, which was a branch of the church in the United States that had built the church and school he had attended as a child in Bluefields, Nicaragua. Barclay worked in various departments with the government. After leaving public works, he took up a post in the post office. Then he went on to the Treasury, ultimately spending the rest of his civil service career in the Customs Department, eventually as the Deputy Collector, where he worked from 1973, as you heard Kevin allude to, until he retired in 1991. Indeed, when we look at it, his was a life of service, and serve he did with pride and distinction. After his retirement, he continued working at home, or from home, a term we are more familiar with these days. For many years, he prepared customs declaration forms for imported goods for various businesses in the island. And if you went to visit him at home, you were sure to find him in his little office, sitting at his desk, surrounded by a slew of paperwork with his radio playing in the background. In time, this gave way to a new role for Barclay, that of grandfather. His first grandchild, Nicholas, was born in September of 1995. And his role of grandfather became almost one like a father, as he played a major role in Nicholas's life. He would fix his bottle, he would feed him, and we knew that he really, really loved Nicholas because he would change his pampers too. He would do all the school runs and take him around, just like he took his children around, to the various extracurricular activities. And he actually taught him to drive. Nicholas always says that he is the person and the man he is today because of his papa. When Kaylee was born in 2010, his heart melted once more, and Craig would have to pick his father up every evening after he got off from work to take him to see Kaylee. And so it was obvious that Barclay was totally devoted to his children and his grandchildren. He was very proud of them and all of their accomplishments. He was always there for them, supporting them every step of the way, providing for their every need. And we can truly say that he always wanted the best for them. In 2018, it was evident that Barclay was beginning to face some challenges with his health, and it wasn't long before he was diagnosed, which was fairly obvious to us, with dementia. He received absolutely wonderful care from his faithful and devoted caregivers, Miss Anastania and Miss Marjorie, who saw to his every need until the end. Barclay's health began to deteriorate, and after a prolonged illness, he quietly passed away on Wednesday, the 7th of June last, just after 11 o'clock in the night at the Georgetown Hospital with Amaris by his side. He was preceded in death by his wife, Cecile, his parents, Verne and Josefa, his sister, Petrona, and his brothers, Armando and Ulrich, and left to mourn Barclay's passing, but with a lifetime of wonderful memories, are his children, Craig and Amaris, his grandson, Nicholas, and his girlfriend, Katerina, granddaughter, Kaylee, daughter-in-law, Johanna, sisters, Mabel and Nella, brothers, Sims and Anthony, his sisters-in-law, Rosa, Kay, Judy, Madeline, Florence, Jeanette, and I think Maker, and Liz, and his brothers-in-law, Randolph, Alan, Franklin, Kelly, and Larry, nieces, nephews, and other relatives and friends. Barclay will be remembered by all of us for all the good that he did while he was here. And today, we pray fervently that his gentle soul rests in peace.
Good afternoon. A reading from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May God bless the reading of this word.
As I sat there and listened to all of the many good things that was said about Mr. Barclay, it almost made me wish I'd known him a little bit better. I was sort of introduced to his immediate family since his passing. I met with, Amaris, I hope it's not too far off, and her son was there when we went to the home to meet with the family. Miss Mabel and Mr. Randolph on the other hand, and later that part of the family along with Mr. Sims I've known for many, many years. Mr. Sims and myself were fellow plumbers for many years and was well acquainted over time. But today, it falls my lot. I was asked to fill in for Pastor Allison, due to the fact that they're, and I understand, attending the annual convention overseas. And as my policy is, it doesn't matter how much I know about a person. It's not, I don't have much to say in funerals about the person, because it's no more we can do for that individual. But those of us that are left behind to suffer the loss and to feel the pain and need the comfort and the encouragement, and last but not least, to realize that this is the way of all the earth. What this family is experiencing today, time lasting, we'll all sit up front like they are today. So as it falls my lot to share the message, I have a very small portion of scripture that I would like to use and then say something from that scripture. But on behalf of my immediate family and our church family, we want to let you all to know that you are and have been in our prayers. In the book of Numbers, that Old Testament scripture, the 23rd chapter and the 10th verse reads like this. Let me die the death of the righteous, and let my last end be like his. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, because we've been privileged, we've been honored to been asked to stand before this audience, Lord, that has gathered together to say their last and pay their last respects to a very great man. We pray today in a very special way that you would help us all to benefit, Lord, from his life, learn from his ways, learn, Lord, the things that are very important in this life. We pray now, Father, that you'll speak to all of our hearts, and we will step back into the shadows and give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, from that very short portion of scripture, there are a few things worth our consideration. One, point number one, it is possible to be righteous. In a world as corrupt and fallen as we live in, with the grace of God, it is still able and possible today to reach that position of being righteous. Not many people even strive anymore to excel in spiritual things the way that is our privilege too. The Bible tells us in 1 John 3:7, he said, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous. Titus 2:11-12 say, the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world. So today, to be righteous is possible, but only through the grace and blood of our Lord and Savior, right. Jesus Christ. Point number two is that the righteous also will die. I've told people many times, salvation will keep you out of hell, but not the grave. This is the way of all the earth. And I'm grateful as that part in the obituary, as Mr. Kurt was reading, where it said that church was important to him. Amaris was telling me some of her dad's experiences and how he was a church-going man while he raised them and so on and so forth until this terrible sickness. This is something that it seemed to be very prevalent today. Strokes and Alzheimer's and dementia. And these are dangerous things. She told me, she said, before my dad got sick, say my dad was really into church. And I said, well, that is very good. And every one of us today, it doesn't matter what happens to us in this life. God is a merciful God. God is a loving God that gave his only begotten son that all of us might be saved. We may all receive him that we may not perish. So no matter what happens to us in this life, we have to realize that to be righteous, we have to be righteous before we die in order to die the death of the righteous. In Genesis 9:28 and verse 29 lets us to know of the one man, basically, that the Bible records that God himself said about Noah in the 7th chapter, in the 1st verse of Genesis, God said to Noah, enter thou into the ark, for thou only have I seen righteous in this generation. But in the 9th chapter, the scripture tells us that Noah lived 950 years and he died. So no matter how righteous we are in this world, we will still die time lasting. So that is why it is important for us to make our calling and election sure, because the righteous too will die. Isaiah 57, verse 1 says, the righteous perisheth, and no man layeth it to heart. And merciful men are taken away, not considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. We don't know all of what lies out of ahead of us. But when a good man is fallen, when a good man dies, a good person dies, it makes our island that much poorer. I believe our island is poorer today because a man like Mr. Barclay has gone and left us. Amen. Point number three, to die the death of the righteous is a death that is desired. But for us to die the death of the righteous, we need to live the life of the righteous. And all of this is possible through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God is a merciful God. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 14:32, the wicked is driven away in his wickedness, but the righteous hath hope in his death. That glorious hope of being able to go and spend eternity and finish eternal life that is to get started here. We're grateful for everyone that was able to come out today to share the loss and to express their condolences and sympathy to this family, because it's not going to end just because we commit the body back to the earth from whence it came. Amaris Craig and Amaris's son, along with all of the family, all of the siblings, all of the whatever relationship he is to you today, that family in general gonna need our prayers beyond even today. God wants us to be ready for this day. So the righteous hath hope in this life, and the righteous have hope in death. 1 Corinthians 9:2-9 says, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for those that love him. We are grateful this afternoon that we can die the death of the righteous. But as I said a little earlier, for us to die the death of the righteous, we first have to find that relationship with God that enables us through his grace to live righteously and godly in this present world. Psalm 34 lets us to know, it's one of my favorite psalms. The scripture says there, verses 15 through 17, he said, a righteous cry, and the Lord heareth and delivereth him out of all their troubles. I am so grateful today that we can strive to be what God would have us to be. You see, a lot of people don't even think about it. Some may not even be aware of it. But Revelation 4:11-4 says, for thy pleasure we are and were created. That is the purpose of us being here, is to bring pleasure to God. So may God strengthen the hearts of everyone that is here. Mr. Barclay's race is run. His chapter of his life is closed. But ours is still able, it's still open. It is still, there is still chance of room and room for improvement in every one of our lives. And we have a responsibility to God to bring pleasure to him. As we become adults, young adults especially, we feel that the pleasure in life is supposed to be solely for us. But we were created to serve God. Scripture tells us if we remember our Creator in the days of our life, life will go on and be so much better. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, said in Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You know, I thought of the psalm that was read, the 23rd psalm. As it got down to that fourth verse, I thought what Jesus said to Mary in John 11, verses 25 and 26. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Liveth and believeth. I believe some of the best known verses in the Bible is John 3, 16, 17, and 18, where Jesus sums up pretty much the gospel and our life here on earth. John 3 and 16, I'm sure we all know right off by heart, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in me should not perish, but have everlasting life. The 17th verse says, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. The 18th verse goes on and throws in a somewhat of a warning. He said, he that believeth not is condemned already. Today, fellow travelers to eternity, we don't have to wait till we get over there to find out that we're condemned. All you have to do is don't believe in the only begotten Son of God, by whose stripes we are healed, and through his blood, our sins are forgiven. He says, without doing that, you stand condemned as we speak. So this afternoon, we don't want to be leaving this life without having made our calling an election sure. May God help every one of us. We are all fellow travelers. We must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ one day to give an account of the things done in our body, in this life, whether they've been good or whether they've been bad. And so today, as we leave here, the Bible lets us to know that the child of God, as that fourth verse said, yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You see, he that liveth and believeth in me, Jesus himself said, shall never die. When we die physically, the body, the Bible says, goes back to the earth from whence it came, but the spirit goes back to God who gave it. And thank God, when we have made our calling and election sure, we will hear from Jesus' own lips, well done, good and faithful servant. So as we travel that way, let's make plans. Let's make plans that as we press on in this life, that we take time for what's really important. I love that part of the scripture, of the life story, where he said church life was important to Mr. Barclay. May God help us all to realize that we all can make of a calling an election sure. Jesus left just pretty much before he left. Over there in John chapter 14, verses 1 to 3, he says, let not your hearts be troubled. If ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare that place, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. We leave these words with you today. While we continue to bear up this precious family, I shared the scripture with Amaris and her son the day we went to the old homestead. We're in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, where the scripture tells us that God is the God of all comfort. He is the God of all comfort. No matter how many calls, no matter how many friends came, for all of that, we would like to thank you. But comfort really only comes from God. And Jesus, our Lord and Savior, say, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. So in times of this grief and loss, let it out. Tears, one songwriter say, is a language that God understands. May God bless you as a family. May you find that comfort that can only be found in Jesus Christ. And as we travel towards eternity, let us remember that to die righteous, it must first be started here. Amen. God bless you all, is my prayer.
We all heard the word, and it was very clear. But just hearing it and leaving this place today and never intending to do it would really be sad. So keep present in your hearts and minds that just like we intentionally get an education and we intentionally make investments, buy a house or whatever we do, the opportunity is there for eternity with Christ, but we must be intentional. Amen. In making that decision while it is still time. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for helping those who have prepared the service for today. Thank you for the message that you brought to us through your servant. Thank you, O Lord God, for the peace and comfort and strength that you have bestowed upon the family members. Lord, we pray that the memories that each one have of their time with Barclay while he was still with us, that those memories will help to minimize the pains that his departure has brought to the family. Father God, much more important than finding comfort and strength through the memories, Lord, help each and every one of the family members to know, Lord God, that this is really not a final moment. It's a final moment here on earth. But Barclay going to be with you, Lord, means that there is life eternal. Yes. And that every family member, every friend, Lord, every acquaintance could join him when we leave this earth, Lord God, if we make our decision while it is still time. Father God, it is my prayer that this message be indelibly impressed upon the hearts and minds of everyone present, because we are not here by accident, but it has been a divine appointment for each of us to have heard this word. Lord, we pray that as we continue, Lord God, by going to the cemetery and whatever will take place there, that you will go with us. And we pray, oh Lord God, that no one in here will forget Titus chapter 2, verses 11 to the end. Lord, that what mankind needs is your grace that brings salvation. Lord, it's clearly stated there in this portion of scripture that that is what we need so we could say no to the world, so we could renounce the passions of the flesh and have self-control in our lives while we wait for the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Lord, a very small portion of scripture, but one that we could focus on and pray for ourselves and our family and our acquaintances, Lord, because the hour is late. Lord, we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And now we will close with the singing of the hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." We'll ask the family members to remain seated, but congregation, would you please stand?
My soul, lose my seat, it feels wrong.
Before we pronounce the benediction, I guess you could see it on the front of your program, but the internment will follow at the Garden of Eden Cemetery, Pedro Castle Road. And the order of leaving the platform would be the ministers and members of the platform leaving the building, ministers and members of the platform, followed by the casket and pallbearers and the immediate family, honorary pallbearers and congregation. And the bulletin says, please drive with headlights in route, on dim en route to the Garden of Eden Cemetery. The procession will go along Walker's Road, Smith Road, Crewe Road, then on to Pedro Castle Road via Shamrock Road. Also, last but not least, in lieu of flowers, donations in memory of the may be made to the Lions Club of Grand Cayman and the Alzheimer's and Dementia Association of the Cayman Islands. Yes, and envelopes are at the back of the church building. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen. Thank you.